Good afternoon. I want to use this as long as I can, but I encourage you, if you want to come forward, you can. I got this kind of sinus thing going on right now, so I will not try to inflict too much pain and discomfort on you, but I'll go as long as I can, and would encourage any of you to ask questions as we go along. I don't mind answering your questions. It's fun to be here today. I want to thank Dr. Bloodworth and Dr. Sullivan and all the faculty and staff for allowing me to come back on campus. It's always fun for Beverly and I to come back. We both graduated. I graduated in 81 and she stayed and finished in 82. But this visit to back to campus has renewed a long-running argument in our family. We met here at Augusta State or Augusta College back from that time. And the entire time we were here, we took one class together, Ralph Walker's political science class. And I always tell Dr. Walker when I see him that Beverly and I took that class together. We read the same book, we studied together, we had the same notes, and it always worked out that she would make a grade one letter higher than mine. And so I still carry that protest along with me. But I thank Karen Mobley and the talented Tiff for inviting me to come and speak to you about the importance of voting and the importance of being politically astute. And without asking your political party affiliation, I'll tell you, the first answer to that question is standing right here. I mean, this is the importance of voting. You may not have voted for me. You may think that I'm the biggest yahoo that never served in the Georgia General Assembly. And if you do, I mean, that's your right. That's one of the things, we have a right to participate in the system. But if you think that and you didn't vote, if you didn't participate, then you don't really have a whole lot that you can say about it. Beyond that, if any of you pay any attention to what's going on in the media, if during the period starting the second week of January to the end of April, if you pay any attention to the kinds of things that me and my colleagues in the legislature do, and if you pay attention to the impact that it has upon you, it will show you right away how important it is for you to be involved in the system, how important it is for you to vote, how important it is for you to pay attention to the things that we consider, because we wield an enormous amount of power. The things that we do impact your lives daily. As I was preparing to come up here this afternoon, I just kind of jotted down a list of some of the things that we have done in my short time in the General Assembly that has had a direct impact on many of you in this room. We have passed legislation that criminalizes a lot of the conduct that you, as young people under the age of 21, participate in. I'm sure all of you have been watching the news and heard about the Janalo Wilson case. That was something that we, my colleagues in the Georgia General Assembly, did. We passed a law that criminalized consensual sex between two minors, and that young man went to jail. The Georgia Supreme Court reversed it, but it took them over 2 years to do that. We did that, didn't do it because the Constitution told us to do it. We did it because some legislator from some community in Georgia thought it was a good idea. He was persuasive enough to go before the Georgia Senate and the Georgia House of Representatives, and it passed. And after it passed, the governor signed it. And we did that completely in the light of day. Wasn't done in secret. The doors weren't locked. The cameras in the chambers of the House and the Senate were working, so if you wanted to turn on Georgia Public Television, you could have probably sat in your living rooms and watched it. All happened, all unfolded. And nobody said anything about it. How many of you in the room are on the Hope Scholarship? I mean, the Hope Scholarship recipients here. Just last session in the General Assembly, we did, we changed the, we changed the courses that could be considered for determining whether or not you have a 3.0 average. And in doing so, we drastically reduced the number of students coming out of high school that are eligible to receive the Hope Scholarship. I won't tell you the name of the school, but there's one high school in Richmond who went from having in the neighborhood of 40 or 50 students who qualified for the Hope Scholarship to their last graduation class, they had two, just by virtue of the one change in the administrative requirements for the Hope Scholarship. I'll tell you another one that we're about to do, and I hope that all of you will think about it and get involved in it. But right now, it appears that the number one issue that we will address in the 2008 session of the General Assembly is tax reform. How many of you want your taxes cut? A lot of hands are going up. We have the Speaker of the Georgia House of Representatives, Glenn Richardson, has proposed tax reform, what he calls the Great Plan. Great Plan to get rid of every ad valorem tax. He wants to get rid of all the ad valorem property taxes. Totals about $9.5 billion in the state. Currently, that $9.5 billion is collected locally by local governments. His position is that we ought to get rid of it, that we ought to replace it with a stepped-up sales tax, and that sales tax should be collected by us in Atlanta, and that we should decide how that $9.5 billion is going to be redistributed back to the local governments for funding of education and those things that have a lower tax funds. I ask you, how many of you think that we will be stronger as members of the General Assembly if we control $9.5 billion of your tax dollars? And how many of you said that they want to make us more stronger, more powerful, more influential than you already think we are? You don't have to raise your hand. I don't think very many of you do. But those are the kinds of things that we do on a daily basis. Let me give you a little of what I call Georgia General Assembly 101. There are 56 members of the Georgia Senate. Politically, that draws down that there's 34 Republicans in the Georgia Senate. There are 22 Democrats. On the House side, there are 180 members of the Georgia House of Representatives. And they just had some folks, which I'm really not sure what their numbers are, but the Republicans control both chambers of the Georgia General Assembly. From a constitutional standpoint, both the governor and the lieutenant governor are Republicans. We live in Richmond County. How many of you live in Richmond County? Richmond County is the county that I represent. It's majority Democrat. And I'm not here to give a partisan talk. We're just want to let you know that how we stand and how the landscape stands and how important it is for you to be a part of the system. We are a majority Democratic county. The last time I sat down with Lynn Bailey at the Board of Elections, she told me that we were 67.4% Democratic lean, which means that the majority of the people who live in Richmond County are Democrats. And so that may help you, that may explain for you some of the decisions that have been made. At the end of this session, the governor rendered some vetoes that were not favorable to Richmond County. Richmond County wasn't the only county that received unfavorable treatment, but we were one of several. But we have to put people in office who are astute, people who can function within the system that is currently in place and who can be persuasive enough, who can use their intellect and their relationships and whatever other resources that are at their ability to make things happen for the people that we serve. And so, in terms of whether or not you need to be politically astute,